Hi everyone, let's talk about more on the React interview questions. So first questions which I usually face is, what is a state object? So state object is a mutable object which actually represents the dynamic data in the component, and whenever it changes, your component will always re-render if you are not overriding should component update method. So if you are changing the state of a parent component, then it is going to re-render the component itself, and in that component, if you are also rendering the child component, then each and every child component will be refreshed. So there can be a case where you are updating the state object in the parent component, and that state you are passing the props in the child component. So whenever you change the state object, it will re-render, right? Render function will get called, and from that render functions, you are actually rendering all the child component. So in that case, you can pass the updated data to the child components like this. So if you are updating the state of parent component, all the child component will re-render. So if you are changing the state of this component will re-render. If you are changing the state of this component will re-render. Okay. So props object is actually immutable object which we are passing from one component to another component as a data source or data communication, because there is no way to pass the data from one component to another component. So props is the way using which we can pass the data, and we can access that in the child component using this dot props dot the props object name. Like here, hello message, I'm passing the name as a world, right? So I can capture that value using this dot props dot name, right? Similarly, there can be a scenario of parent and child component. From the parent friend list component or the friends component, you are passing the list of friends to the friend list component, right? Some static array or some data which you are getting from the API call. So this question of how to optimize the performance, you will be able to answer if you have worked enough onto the React platform by just using the uglification, minifications, and doing the lazy loading, and adding the optimal source map for your React build. If you are using Create React app, and then it's a black hole because everything is being done by the Create React app. But if you are using the Webpack with the React application, then you have a lot of chances. You got a lot of opportunity to understand how you can write a lot of optimization in Webpack 4 for your React application, like adding the required plugin, capturing the source map for your final build, or analyzing the bundle size, or analyzing the dependencies in your bundle. All these things you can do if you are not using the Create React app and you are using the Webpack 4 with the React application. Okay, but from the code wise, you can use the lazy loading, so your final bundle will not be a single use bundle. You will get a chunks, and you will be able to do the lazy load of all these modules. Then this is the basic questions, right? Because people don't understand the basic in-depth concept. They start writing the Angular application using Angular CLI, React application using Create React App, Vue application using Vue CLI. So Create React App is actually a tool like Angular CLI, where you can bootstrap your application in just a few seconds, and you can just run the Hello World application in just 10 seconds, right? What do you need to do? Create React App new, or the application name, it will give you the complete skeleton. So this is like a boilerplate you are getting. Now you can start writing your component. So what happens when you call the set state? So a lot of things happens, right? When I call the set state should component update, that update state lifecycle gets triggered, and if should component update is, we are not overriding should component update, then it will re-render the component and children also, if there are children in that component. So element and a component, right? So component is a React component, but the element is actually the smallest unit which is created with the from the JSX. So if you are writing the division, inside division you have h1 tag, so that division will be converted into the react.create element, and it will have the h1 tag inside it. So React element or react.create element, these elements is represented by the DOM nodes. An element is the combinations of all of those Create React elements. So I would use the class component over the functional component. So there are different ways of writing the component in React, right? You can write a stateless component, stateless functional component, or stateful component where you are writing the ES6 class, writing the DOM events, writing the set state method, or I mean you are updating the state and rendering the child component. In that case, if you are having a state, go ahead and write the ES6 class. But where you are just capturing the data and showing them in the list, there is no point of writing the class. You can just fine. You are fine just writing a simple function. You can just write a functional component instead of writing the another ES6 class by extending the React.component. Okay. So the use case is, if you have a state object in your component and writing the DOM event, then write the ES6 class. So what are the references? We talked about that in the previous video. So references we are using to capture the value from the DOM. You can see the DOM fields like text field, text area. So what we can do, like we used to provide the references. So this reference will capture the value from this input. So this is the short way to capture the value whatever you are typing in the input text field. And references are actually, we are actually creating the references in the form fields to capture the value of all those fields. And you can also get the value using this dot references dot reference name dot get DOM node dot value. Okay, another important question is, why we actually, whenever we iterate or whenever we render the multiple child component, why we pass the key here? Because React, consider it's a parent component, right? So it's like a YouTube video list component, and it is rendering YouTube video list item components. So this list component is having 10 child components, because in the iteration you are rendering a single child component 10 times. So you are passing a key. Why the key is important? Key is important to track each and every DOM changes happening in the individual component. Without this key, React will not be able to identify uniquely about each and every child component. So this key is required for the reference for the React to track each and every child component. So what is the difference between the controlled and uncontrolled component? Consider this text field component. Here, whenever you are doing your own change on this text field, you are updating the username, right? And this update username is actually just setting the value of this text field. So controlled component are those components, whenever you are type, consider this is a component, right? The value of this component is not driven by you. It is driven by the state. What value you are getting in the text field, that is coming from the state, not whatever you are typing. I'm typing, there is own change is getting triggered, own change is updating the state, that state is getting reflected in the value field, not what I'm typing. So I'm not controlling this text field. React is controlling this text field by updating the state object every time whenever I'm typing. So the new state object I'm able to see in the text field. This is the one of the best example of a controlled component, because the value of this text field is not driven by me. This is driven by the React, because value is actually the state property, right? And state is getting changed whenever I'm typing something into this text field. Update username is actually updating the state object. Every time whenever you change the state object, this is being populated into the value field. Okay, so if you just hard code some value here, then you will not be able to change the value, right? So uncontrolled component, where we are not controlling the value of particular component coming from state. So if I just value equal to, I just pass any random value, or I'm not updating the state from this DOM event, that is uncontrolled component, because the value inside that text field, I'm not controlled by some state object, right? So this is one of the important questions. What is a controlled and uncontrolled component? Next thing is, in which lifecycle event you will make a API call, right? Another important question. So you can see that this lifecycle is like this. Get initial state, then component will mount, and then render, and component will mount, and then that's all. So you will be doing this on the mounting process, right? Because during the mounting, before rendering, you want the data onto the UI, right? You can just show some kind of a loading, but data should be there in the mounting process. So forget about this particular portion. We need to do that after get initial state and before the rendering process, right? So I have one way is you can just trigger the component will mount method, write the code inside this using the Axios and request module and get the data and update the state object so that while reaching to the render function or showing the component onto the UI, you have the data coming from API. Or you can also do that on component did mount because that is being called just after the render function. So there are two different options, but better you do it in the component will mount. So these are just different lifecycle events and it is showing this picture. If this is returning true, then only the updation will happen. If this is returning false, no re-rendering will happen, right? So this is the initialization, mounting process, updation process and unmounting process. So you should be aware of each and every lifecycle method. Okay, that's it.